for allowing us to speak. My name's Heidi Miller. I'm one of the five Miller siblings who grew up at 598 Logan Berry Drive, site of the January 10th MCSD Fire Road landslide being discussed tonight. My 90-year-old parents have lived there since 1965, and I'm here representing my parents and our family. We need to fix the landslide before the next rains, where there's a great possibility that the rest of the fire road above my parents' home will continue to slide, burying our family home in mud. We must be allowed to access the MCSD fire road above our property to begin our stabilization project. The majority of the mud and debris in the landslide is from the fire road and above it, not from my family yard. To quote my mother, please tell them tonight to take their dirt back. We don't want it. My brother and sister will speak in more depth about our concerns and our requests. So to give you a visual aid to follow, I have some photographs and some documents for your review. And please put yourself in our shoes. If this was your 90-year-old parents who have lived there for 52 years and the landslide occurred above your property and sliding into your property, wouldn't you want to repair it as soon as humanly possible for their safety? My parents have given so much back to this community in the past 52 years. My father has written for the Independent Journal for the past 30 years, oftentimes about life in Marinwood. I'll leave copies of my father's most recent book for you all, should you wish to have it. And I thank you for your time, and I'd love to hand some handouts to you.
And my parents, Alan and Barb, still live there, who you just met. And on January 10th, during a big storm, the MCSD fire road collapsed into my folks' backyard. The first three photos show the slide, you know. Now, MCSD emergency responders and the fire department came the next day and did a heroic job of helping my brother to cut drainage swales and to tarp the slide. Photo 4 shows the fix, which really just looks like a big blue chart. Doesn't show very much. Since that time, we filled out claims to MCSD for repair, and we had meetings with staff, and sent all the information that was requested. We paid for geotech engineers to design repair, and we have a bid from a contractor to fix the landslide in the most cost-effective but long-lasting manner before the rains come back in October. We're feeling kind of nervous. You can see page 5, which shows the repair plan. The geotech engineers state that the slide was initiated on the MCSD fire road, which is obvious if you look at it. You need to kind of go up there and take a look. They also state that the area has a high probability of failing again, with the possibility of the entire fire road washing into our backyard. Page 6 shows their statement. It's from the design engineers, their Miller Pacific, which are highly regarded in Marin County. All this info has been provided to MCSD. Now, what we need right now is the only way for the contractors to access the site with heavy equipment required to fix the slide is via the MCSD fire road. We have formally requested permission to access the fire road and have provided all the insurance, info, and details requested by MCSD. We have received a very lengthy permission document written entirely in legalese from MCSD, which is jammed with statements about our agreement that MCSD has no liability now or any time in the future. That's page 7. I marked it up with a marker and a little bit of blue writing. This document is all about denial of liability for landslide and all possible future events. There's verbiage in there that talks about events in the future originating anywhere, perhaps much, much farther up the hillside. We obviously agree that MCSD will have no liability in the event of anything happening while the landslide repairs are in progress. That's what access documents are all about. But trying to force my 90-year-old father and family to sign all sorts of liability waivers, which have no relevance to the access and repair, and 100% to do with CYA for the MCSD, is kind of, we feel like it's kind of extortion. So we need permission to access the slide to fix the access the yard to fix the landslide. The South right now is experiencing all sorts of hurricane damage. And if we're being denied access to fix a landslide, I mean, it just doesn't really make sense. If our repair is delayed by MCSD, then my 90-year-old parents end up covered in mud to cover your butt, then how do you think this will sound in court? We're asking for an access document with all the regular provisions of a regular access document. And we have contractors who are ready to go on schedule. Right now. Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else?
Good evening. My name is Wendy Miller. I'm another one of the Millers, and I'm supporting Mom and Dad tonight. And as you heard, on January 10th, the Marinwood Fire Road behind our house collapsed in a landslide and filled the yard with mud. The staff responded heroically and created new drainages, tarped the landslide, channeled the floodwater, erected exclusionary fencing and hazard signs on what was left of the fire road. They did repairs and intervention on the landslide literally dozens and dozens of times between the landslide and now. They have been there over and over and over again doing maintenance that they had never done in the past. After the landslide, we were confident that MCSD would be eager to fix the fire road and the landslide and make the road safe again for the public who still use that trail with their dogs, with their friends, and their kids every single day. We were wrong. We learned that MCSD wants nothing to do with the dirt, the road, the property, or the safety of the public. In July, they officially declined to fix the landslide, saying it was the decision of their insurer. The Miller family's claim was rejected in a one-sentence letter that provided no reason for the rejection, no contact name, no email address, no phone number, no case number to refer to. No insurer ever visited the site or wrote a report or even signed a form. There's no evidence that our claim was ever even submitted to any insurer. And I learned just today that MCSD automatically rejects all claims, regardless of merit. We hired geologists and engineers to evaluate the landslide and design the repair. The engineers warned us that if the repairs are not completed before the next rainy season, there's a significant risk that the landslide will expand and completely wash out the road, right into my parents' yard and home. Despite the warning, MCSD refuses to repair the landslide or the fire road. They're willing to put the public and the residents at risk. Last month, we formally requested access to allow our contractors to complete the repairs and avoid a possible tragedy. The response was 6 pages of jumbled legalese that hardly address access at all, but instead repeatedly denied responsibility and forces up to us to maintain the public property forever, and other conditions that have nothing to do with access. Basically, this access document is an extortion agreement. It's shameful that Marinwood refuses to accept responsibility to fix the road on their land that failed due to decades of neglect and sticking residents with the bill. It's doubly shameful that they'll attempt to blackmail these residents into giving up their rights in exchange for their safety. Our request tonight is simple. We ask the board of directors to direct staff to authorize access to the landslide to complete the repairs with reasonable conditions that are relevant to that access. Our grading contractor is scheduled to start. Any more delay will cause the project to be canceled with possibly tragic consequences. Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else?
Hello, my name is Chris Herder. I live across the street from the Millers. I have lived on Loganberry since 1975. I like the Millers very much, but I would be delighted to have them to dinner. I don't want them to arrive at dinner because the hill comes down and shoots them across the street into my dining room. The fire road right in that area is coming down what is the natural water path. That's where the waterfall comes down there and pulls in right behind that property. So that's a natural water path into the aquifer that then continues on under Loganberry through my yard and then the neighbor's yard and then down on Kernberry. So there's a there's a substantial risk there. I'm not surprised that it washed out. The fire road was not cut with proper drainage on the high side, so it eventually washed out. I have read the document, and I'm uncomfortable as a Marinwood resident that this is how we're responding to it. It just seems like if we own the fire road, and I guess the question is, do we not own the fire road? We, Marinwood, if it's our fire road and our fire road fell into somebody's yard, I don't understand the justification for not being responsible for it. And if the insurance company is refusing coverage for something that it sounds like we should have been insured for, then that seems like a bad faith insurance contract and you go after the insurance company. So I don't understand why we're not covering this, but I certainly support the Millers' view that I don't think they're asking you to pay for it. They're just saying, let us fix it, but don't try and claim that if we fix it, then at some point in the future, one of the Marinwood fire trucks, because the hill will eventually catch fire, it always does, and that fire truck suddenly, falls into the Millers' backyard. Are the Millers now liable for that because their fire road slid? So I just don't understand the justification. I think we need to look at this one more time and make sure that we're not missing something obvious. Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, my name is Alan Miller. Please excuse me if I don't stand.
Quite all right.
My silence is perhaps a bit unusual, but again, Barbara and I are not in great health, and we are grateful that our children, two of them or three of them who are here tonight, are representing us and our family, and we are really apprehensive about this winter, which, including lots of things, but including what seems to be the general indifference of staff with the Marinwood District, we haven't had any positive response from anyone about any of this problem. And my guess is that the consequences of this whole affair could get more severe in the near future. So Barbara and I are grateful that our kids are here and they will represent us in everything going on here now and in the future. Thank you.
Anybody else?
My name is Dolly Andres, and I live next door to the Millers. I've been living there since 1977. They are wonderful people. They have done everything to try to be able to fix this issue, and I feel like that it also will affect our property. If it affects our property, it's going to affect the other property next to us, and it's going to just tumble them down, as well as Chris, who's across the street with the aquifer, as he explained, which I didn't realize that. The
you're saying I'm going to need a bigger dinner, is what you're saying. Yeah. They're all coming.
So I'm very concerned about it, and I want to voice my concern to the board that we are speaking, I'm speaking for myself, and I assume my husband would agree with you, that we're on notice that this does need to be addressed, and they do need access to this, so it doesn't happen to anybody else.
Anybody else? My name is Robert Owen. I live on Juniper Berry. I have about 30 years. My wife, Jill, is the niece of Alan and Barbara. When this happened, my son and I ran up there to keep mud from going into the back door of their house, which we managed to get out there. Thanks to another one of their kids, Andy, who was around, we all had to do a lot of scrambling to protect. In the first instances, when mud was flowing from up there above the fire road, through the fire road and into their yard. And then I must say I haven't paid too much attention to this other than there's the big gap out there ever since, until I saw the letter asking the Millers here to indemnify the board for anything that might ever happen on that hillside now and into the future. I've negotiated a few agreements. I've never seen one as self-serving and interested in equity as the one that you sent to the Millers. And I'm just asking you, what are you going to do about it?
Anybody else?
I'm the niece of Alan and Barb, and I've been observing the landslide. Today I started thinking about contacting some of the neighbors, and I've just begun. I've only talked to a couple of them, but they did write out little statements of support for the position that the Community Services District should grant a permit.
Give them to them. Submit those to you?
Can I give them to you?
They couldn't make it tonight, so these people.
Which one can I give them to?
Give them to the chair.
Any other comments, Stephen?
So I know because this wasn't on the agenda, we can't do any action tonight. I recommend that you set aside a special meeting to address their concerns. For those of you who don't know, I've been filming the meetings for, I don't know, 5 years, 4 years. And from time to time, the subject of the fire road has come up. What maintenance is being done? And mostly the response has been a shrug, well, we don't really go up there. And it's really unfortunate because there's some very simple ways to maintain roads so they don't erode away. I'm not familiar with the location being discussed tonight, but I think it's impressive that everyone's here, and they're really, it seems like taking a very reasonable position, and there's an issue of liability. We had a very expensive slide that happened about 10 years ago. It cost the district, I think, about $300,000. The total liability was like $1.2 million. We got lucky there. There's the money, but also the equity and how you treat the citizens and, of course, personal safety, which is more important than anything. So I encourage you to really listen to the Millers and schedule a special meeting as soon as possible to address this very topic so you can take action. Thank you.
Thank you, Stephen.
If you'll excuse us,
yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
Oh,
absolutely.
Thank you.
Come on.
Any other?
Here's Mr. Dunn.
Chris that concludes the public comments.
That's a good question.
Creation of the Ridgeway CSC Emergency Services Succession Committee to analyze and recommend potential alternatives.
Well, I'm Jenna. The Queenstown Fire Road, we did list the Idleberry Trail there behind 598 Loganberry, which we heard a lot about earlier this morning. One thing that I've been very clear also in informing the Millers, and they know I've submitted that primarily for their family's benefit, is if they do move forward with the project, that's going to negatively impact any chances to get any level of FEMA reimbursement. For FEMA does not deal with public citizens, nor have they gone through, they're not treating it as a public works project, so that if they move forward, it's going to remove that one from the list. But that has nothing to do with it. If they move forward with their project, it will negatively impact its ability to be eligible as for disaster aid funding reimbursement, because they're not a public entity. FEMA doesn't deal with public entities.
So we would have to do that.
Yes, going through all of the same public works processes. And they haven't determined eligibility on that site yet.
And that's why we didn't proceed.
Correct. They're very well aware of all that.
Just going back to Loganberry Company, I want to understand what happened. So FEMA is now busy with the horrific stuff that's happening in the south. Chances are we'll be waiting a long time until they determine the eligibility, possibly, you know, months.
Yeah, I don't know.
It's not unreasonable.
It's not unreasonable. I wouldn't even begin to give you a projection of time. And I'm hopeful now that they finally provided me these documents from their visit in July, that this is what starts their process. They really have not much there doing in terms of determinations after those documents are done.
Yeah, but aside from the timeline now, the possible scenario is FEMA determines, yes, the site is eligible for funding, at which point we will just fix it or do studies or use the study that was done already and then just proceed with fixing.
We could potentially use their study, and then you'd have to go into relooking at what the study recommended, which their study actually recommended four different potential options of repair. The issue with this slide is that it occurs on private residence property as well as into district open space property. It goes far beyond the request was not strictly for access. The request was very clearly to encroach the district's open space with their project. So for it to be posed that they all were asking for is access was actually, in my opinion, a misrepresentation of the situation that is going on here. But when you move forward with it, then it becomes a public works project, at which point it'd have to go through an RFP process, you'd have to go through the bid process. FEMA requirements are equally, if not more so, strict.
And if FEMA determines that it's not eligible, then we are not going to do anything with this?
I don't know, that determination hasn't been made yet.
Thank you, I just need an option.
No, you're fine. But what I would also say is their engineered report, as well as our insurance company who has been on site, who actually has communicated directly with the person who said that, I don't even know that it ever got submitted directly to our insurance, all kind of concur that this clearly was an event caused by excessive rainfall and sheet flow coming down from the hills above, not a level of grading or this object caused this slide. I mean, it was clearly an act of nature, which is why our insurance initially rejected the claim.
Stephen?
Okay, so three items. First of all, with regards to the notice, sounds like you're making a calculation, and by the way, thank you very much for a little bit more information on that project. Seems like you're making a calculation that we want the FEMA money, we don't want the Millers to do it necessarily, And boy, that seems like a very risky proposition. If there is an accident there, I can assure you there will be a lawsuit. And we will more than likely lose that lawsuit. And the reputation of the community. I really think that you need to bump that up to try to figure out how you can solve this. I mean, wouldn't it be great if we didn't have to do anything there, that the Millers would take care of it, and all we had to do was provide them access and a little bit of comfort that we're not going to stip them for liability that they shouldn't have to shoulder. So I think you're making a wrong decision if you think that you can simply wait for the FEMA to get back from Irma to decide whether or not they're going to fund that project. I think that's pretty clear that something needs to be done. So
back on the Millers, if we may, for a minute. Because Eric shared some of the correspondence and the soils report, which they are misinterpreting, it's very clear. Does it say anything about this in the report that we have in our packet that she gave us that the fire road had anything to do with the problem? But in any event, I think staff has been encouraging them to do their project. And to that end, Eric put together an agreement that had two pieces. If for some reason they are ignoring one of the pieces, the only thing they're talking about is the access across our property to get to the repair. But the other increment that is somehow missing their understanding is that work is proposed on our property and we have to give permission for it. And Eric's been going back and forth with them. The only thing I can suggest, because it's, you know, we don't even have a special meeting, he's taking care of it. The only thing I might suggest is that we talk to the person in county council who drafted this agreement to see if it couldn't be softened in any way to still properly protect the district, but not feel we're throwing everything on the Millers. I realize that person from county council is, I guess, on vacation or something. I don't know when he gets back. And obviously time is of the essence and we need to move on with this, but they need to agree to our requirements, whatever they may be, before we can let them go work on our property and take access across our property.
So as an engineer, you probably, you most likely understand it much more than I do. What the engineering drawings propose is not only to fix their property, but also to make changes to our property, and that's pretty much what the county council has an issue with, correct?
No. The county council doesn't have an issue with the work. It's just putting a whole bunch of the legalese they talked about. Maybe he overdid it. I don't know.
The document was drafted based solely off of county templates, several of which I was provided, both through Public Works as well as through Open Space and Modified to fit our needs. I gave them to them, hoping to expedite it, and clearly letting them know that I've also submitted this for a legal review, at which point it might come back with the alterations needed. In the event that these alterations are not needed, I'm providing this to you now so we can hopefully start the signature process, at which point they threw up a million and one red flags and said, no, all we've requested is access, when the reality is no, your original request was to encroach on district property, at which point to do the work, not accessing the work. They came back to me after the fact of, hey, we need to, it turned out our contractor has to go across your property to get to the site. And I said, okay, I would need an access plan from your contractor, and that'll be part of your request. So the agreement was a response to their original request to do the work. Access to the site is but one component of that request.
They are actually asking to make improvements on our property, is that correct?
As well as theirs, correct.
Okay, who accepts responsibility for those improvements.
Correct. That's exactly the.
I mean.
But that's not what they're about.
No, that's what's in there that's making them nervous, let's say. Well, and it may be that it's right on what we ought to be saying.
Yeah.
Or it may be that it could be softened some so we can get on with this without endangering the district or committing the district to something that shouldn't be committed to.
Yeah.
Because for me, encroachment could be just access, or it could be also work done on our property.
No, the headscarp of the slide extends up into our property.
Yeah.
And so the solution is to build an earth buttress. They're basically going to fill it back in from starting
right.
at the bottom
right.
down by their yard.
Up, yeah.
And they're going to build it all the way up and tie into the existing ground above the headscarf. So they're going to be on our property.
And they will be doing work to our property?
Yes.
According to an engineering study?
Right.
Can I make one comment? Well, I understand that this stemmed from the discussion of our OES claims that are out there, and this site is a portion of it. I think we're going a little bit beyond the scope of the OES thing and into this very specific project and what their needs are, and I would be a little bit careful on the level of detail of conversation that we're having at this point.
Okay. Is there future?